It's so great to be in People Church and here in Chicago. What a great city. Why wouldn't you want to live here? This is fantastic. And shops are so much cheaper. That's what my shopaholic son has discovered, and he wants to go shopping at every shop that we have. His name is Caleb. He's 9 years old. So anyway, that's enough of that. Let's pray and let's believe God to speak to us. Let's believe. How many believe the Bible is alive? God's word is true. So let's believe for that this morning. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we just come to you. We ask that your word would find place within our hearts. We ask that it would become alive and active within us. Lord, you promised that your word is sharper than any two-edged sword, that it would divide, it would conquer, it would do amazing things in our life. And so this morning, as we unpack your word, as we listen to what you have to say, I pray that Holy Spirit, you'd come and fill our hearts, come and fill our lives, come and fill our minds, that we'd leave this place different, changed, with a fresh spring in our step, ready to take on the world in the name of Jesus. And everybody said together,
amen.
Amen. You can be seated. I hope you can understand my accent, but then I figured if you can understand Pastor Chris, you can understand anybody. And how do you know if an Australian likes you? They make fun of you. How do you know if they don't like you? They make fun of you. So the rule in life is simple. Just dare to believe that everybody likes you. And you'll be a lot happier in life, and life will be a lot better for everybody. So is that okay? Well, I'm now residing, our family is residing, my wife, our two boys, I have one son, we have one son's 26, one son who is 9 years old, about to turn 10, and we live now in Virginia Beach, Virginia, and so we're southerners now, so you'll have to forgive me for being a southerner in the northern states, and we're having a great time in Virginia, enjoying the beach down there, enjoying life down in that part of the world. Originally from Australia, as you might have figured, came from a struggling tiny little church called Hillsong Church in Australia, and now connected to a church called Wave Church in Virginia Beach. We have 8 different locations, and I help all our campuses to just do what they do. Well, I want to talk this morning out of Luke chapter 15. I want to unpack hopefully a well-known passage of scripture for you. And my goal is that you'll leave here with a fresh revelation of who God is, what sin is, and what salvation is, and how to apply that to your life. I want you to leave this place with a fresh love for God and a fresh understanding that God loves you. And so we're going to turn straight to that passage. Let's go to Luke chapter 15. And I think it's verse 11. There you go. And we're going to start reading from there. But I need to tell you something beforehand, because I need to give you a little backdrop. So let's start here. It says, to illustrate the point further. And my screen's gunned out here, so if someone can help me with the time and so on, that would be really helpful. But to illustrate this point further is really an important factor, because it starts in obviously verse 1 to 3. And in verse 1 to 3, it has this really interesting part. It tells us there are two groups of people that gather together. There's these people they call the tax collectors and the sinners. I always laugh when I hear that. You know, it's like tax collectors and sinners. If you work for the IRS here this morning, we love you, okay? It's not that we don't like you, okay? It's just, I'll explain that in a second. And there's this other group of people, and I'm going to put them over here. They're the religious people. They're the people who read the Bible. They're the people who are the priests. They're the people who are scribes, they're Pharisees, they're teachers of the law. They are the good people, the nice people. They go to church, the churchy sort of people. And they're in this room together. Now, why do they not like one another? Because it's this group of people who the Bible says they don't like one another, and they're looking at this group of people and they're complaining about them all the time. They're saying, these people, see, Jesus hangs out with these people. These people, they're the tax collectors. They're the same. Jesus, it's not good that Jesus is hanging out, eating meals with tax collectors and sinners. And so from our perspective, we listen to that and we read that and think, well, that just doesn't make a lot of sense. Why did that upset them that much? Well, let me explain. Here is a tax collector and a sinner, these are the people that have actually hurt people. These are people that are traitors to their nation. At this point in time, Israel is an invaded nation, and there are people there. There are Romans, before that were Greeks, before that all sorts of people. And for hundreds of years, they've been an oppressed group of people by invading armies. And the current invading army was the Romans, who had taken up residence there, and they demanded tax from people. Now, no one likes paying tax, but you don't like paying tax to another country. You don't like paying tax to somebody else. In fact, the entire country of America was founded on tax with representation. You hated the fact that you had to pay tax to another country, so much so that you went, "We have had enough," and created your own country on it. So you can synergize with it. You understand. So these people here, these were tax collectors who were their fellow country Israeli Jewish people who had sided with the Romans to collect taxes. Now, what's interesting about this group of people is that they also, if you don't pay your tax, then what these people can do is take you and have you imprisoned and have you put away until you pay your taxes. Not only that, they can actually take the tax that's for Rome and then they add their own tax on top of that. So everyone over on this side, the religious people and the average person, they've probably had to deal with these people. They've probably been ripped off by these people. They've probably been hurt by these people, and they probably have someone they know, someone they care about, who has been imprisoned or put in prison or beaten up by these people because of what they want. So now you can understand the tension in the room. Jesus is meeting up with these people, and these people here, the religious goody-goody two-shoe people, are sitting there. Why, Jesus, are you meeting with those people? And to answer the question, Jesus tells three parables. He tells the parable of a lost sheep, a lost coin. That's to get the message across that God wants to find lost people. And when lost people are found, incredible joy hits the place and the city. So God wants to find lost people. He's committed to finding lost people. He's committed to that process. And once lost people become found, joy breaks out, not just locally, but in the entire city. And I want to say that you and I need to understand that this city needs us to be found, because when we're found, joy can come to this city. When we're found, this city can find hope. When we become found, then this city can find far more joy and hope than it ever thought of possible. And that's just the way God works. And so this is what Jesus is doing. He's answering the question that these people are posing. And now we come to the third parable. It's often called the parable of the prodigal son. Now, I'm not being a good English student, because I am from Australia after all. We say aluminium instead of aluminum when we say all sorts of weird words, and so you understand. No, I'm joking. It's all right. But this word prodigal is a strange word. I used to think it meant bad, naughty, you know, something, you know, prodigal son. He's a bad son. Naughty. Shouldn't do that sort of thing. But it actually doesn't mean that at all. The word prodigal means wasteful, extravagant, in how you do life. So this is about a son that is wasteful, that's extravagant, and in the way in which he does life. Now, I want to flip it on its head before we go any further. I actually think that's the wrong title for that son. I actually think God is prodigal. God is, when he comes to you and I, is extravagant to the point of most people think wasteful. But God is redefining your value in the midst of all this. He's saying you are worth this. You are worth so much more. So when we look at what God does to redeem us, to get a hold of us, to save us, to make us found, he does it with an excessive, over the top abundance that just blows your mind. And we think, God, this is too much, it's too big. And that's what God is wanting you to understand. You are so much more valuable than what you and I would understand, okay? You understand? You're following along with me? So let's now pick up the story. To illustrate this point further, Jesus told them this story. A man had two sons. How many sons?
Two.
Very good. You're following along. So the younger son told his father, "I want my share of the estate." And I love this. "I want my share of the estate before you die," which is a rather unusual thing to say. Now, in that culture, we listen to that right now and we think, well, you know, that's a bit, you know, it's a bit. But in that culture, what you're really saying is this: I want you to die because I want your stuff now. because you didn't get the stuff until the father died. So when you said that, when Jesus is saying that, he's talking to these two groups of people. He's saying there was these two sons. One of the sons said to the father, I want you to die so I can have your stuff. You're in my way. I don't like how you live. I don't like what you're about. I want to live life my own way. Now, the religious people are going, this is sounding like a good story. Because they're going, finally somebody is going to tell these people what they need to hear. You with me? That's what they're thinking. Finally, finally, finally. Now, what happens next blows these people's minds. He says, so the father, what? He what?
Agreed.
He agreed. He said yes. Like, that is just crazy stuff. He said yes. This is a wealthy father in the story, and he said yes, you can have it. The son said, I want to live life my own way. I want to do my own thing. I want to just live life the way I want to live life. I want to groove and roove, whatever. I want to do my deal. And the father said, if you want to do it, go do it. Now, these people here are like, there's murmuring now to the full extreme. What's going on? What's going on? They're in meltdown mode. Because Jesus seems to agree that these people have a right to do whatever they like and be rude to their father. Because we know that the father Jesus is trying to allude here is actually not a real father, but a father in heaven, a godly father. God has been, we'll talk about that in a few minutes. But he says here, so his father agreed to divide his wealth between his two sons. And so a few days later, the younger son packed up all his belongings and moved to a distant land. And there he wasted all his money on wild living. Do you know, a lot of people in life want what God wants them to have. They just don't want God. They want a life that God can give. They just don't want to do it God's way. They just don't want what God has. They say, well, you know, God, you're a bit out of touch. I'm sorry. You're a bit old school. You know what I mean? You just don't understand. I want what you got. I just don't want how you do it. And that is never possible. It doesn't work that way. You can't have what God has by doing it your own way. And that's the first part of this story. So the younger son comes to a point about his time, his money ran out. He's got a lot of money, so he's done a lot of partying. He's party, 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 but he's run out of money. And it says a great famine swept the land and he began to starve. Now, he persuaded a local farmer to hire him, and the man sent him into his field to feed the pigs. Now, these people here are beginning to get under control, the religious people, because Jesus has gone on from the story, and now this younger son has squandered all his money. Now he's about to get his just desserts. He's about to get it, and they're back on the track now. Let's get him. Let's tell him what they need to know. And now, see this thing here, it doesn't make sense to you and I, but this whole concept of feeding pigs is about doing something that is unthinkable as a Jewish person, to feed pigs unclean. Now, what had these people done? These people had in real life sided with an enemy invading army and said, we want to serve a different king. We don't want to be part of our country. We're going to serve that person, and they're doing the unthinkable. So Jesus locks in to where they're at. You tracking along? You with me? So Jesus has got them both on the edge of their seats. Now these people are going, oh my gosh, are we really going to get it? I mean, we sort of had a break before. It seemed like the Father was prepared to give us blessing, but I don't understand. Now Jesus is talking about feeding pigs. That's us. We're feeding pigs. And these religious people over here, they're rubbing their hands together. They're like, finally, 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 when are they going to get some fire, some brimstone, maybe the ground opening up, you know, and it's going to happen. You with me? That's the nature of what's going on. That's where they're locating themselves. That's where they're at. And it says the young man becomes so hungry that even the pods he was feeding, the pigs look good to him. You know you're in trouble when you want to eat the pig food. Yeah. See, it doesn't make sense to us Americans. You know, us Americans, we love our bacon. You have bacon on donuts. Like, who invented that? Like, what were you thinking one day? Where should we put bacon? I know, a dessert. We've had it for the main, we've had it for the starters. Now let's have it for the dessert. So sometimes it gets a little lost in the translation when we realize that a good Jewish person wanted nothing to do with bacon, nothing to do with pigs, nothing to do with any of that stuff. So he's looking at that, but says no one gave him anything. Let's read on. So when he finally came to his senses, say that for me, he what? Oh, come on, say it as if you mean it. He what? So what did he do? He came to his senses. What does his coming to his senses mean? He says, at home, even the hired servants have enough food or have food enough to spare, and here am I dying of hunger. The problem with the son at the beginning was he wanted what the father had. He didn't want the father's ways. He wanted the blessing of the father, but he didn't want the father. I suggest to you he hasn't changed. Because all he really wants is food. And so he's sitting there thinking, so he's coming to his natural senses, but he hasn't come to a reality of his situation. He's come to the senses that, you know what, God loves me and this father loves me and I shouldn't, you know, I may as well go home, but he hasn't really had a revelation. I want to submit to you that a lot of people in church are like that. They turn up to church, they think that, you know, they're going to get some good stuff, but they really don't understand how much God really loves them. They really don't understand how much God is really for them. They really don't understand that. And that's where this story takes another turn, because it's the trip home that really changes the lives of these people right here. And turns these people into some sort of screaming heap over here as we try and figure out how the religious and how the irreligious try and make sense of this. He says, I'll go home and say to my father, Father, I have sinned. No, that doesn't sound good enough. Father, I have sinned. You and I do that all the time. When we go to God, we're like, oh God, oh God, oh, I don't sound like I mean it. Let's do it properly. Father, yes, yes, Father. Oh. It's a really dumb thing to do because it's not impressing anybody. You know, it's just an act because God's got some good things that you want and you're trying to manipulate God to get you what you want, which is the problem all along, which is where humanity has been ever since the fall, and it doesn't really help much, but at least it's a step in the right direction. It's a step towards a hope and a future. It's a step towards something that'll try and help us. And so he says, I'll go home and said, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you, and gets his best religious voice on and does the whole deal of sackcloth and the ashes or whatever else, and he's got to walk slow to make it look like he's really meaning. You know the way we do it, we come to the back, we sit up in the back row, not meaning anything about people in the back row, and we don't want to enter in, so we, you know, we've done something wrong, so we don't lift our hands, you know, we can't do that yet, got to wait a little while before I can lift my hand, and then eventually, you know, I'll be, oh, you know, because I don't feel good about me. This is the dumbest thing you can do. And that's what this story is trying to show us. He says, I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Please take me on as a hired servant. Keep reading on. It says, so he returned home to his father. And while he was still a what? A what? I love the fact that God is looking. He's not, you know, a lot of people think God is so far away, but you know, he's got razor sharp eyes that can see you from wherever. He is a long way up. Do you know what he's looking for? He's looking for you to be starting to head. The moment that sun started turning around, the moment you and I start moving towards God, there's a joy. There's God in heaven going, ah! Have a look, 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 angels come. The angels are like, again, you know, and so it's all going on. See what's happening. So a long way up, he's still like, the father saw him coming, filled with love. Isn't that interesting? It says filled with love and compassion. He what? Ran. See, you and I understand that that's normal. In this culture, it ain't normal. Men do not run. Women run, children run, men sit. Men sit at the gate. Men have to keep their dignity. Because if you're a man, you've got flowing robes. And if you're a man of distinction and a man of value in the community, you've got robes everywhere. You can't run. There's too much going on. You got too many clothes. So to run in that culture, you have to grab your robes. You've got to pull them up. And you've got to start showing your legs. Now, showing your legs is okay here, but back then it ain't. That is disgraceful. You would be shunned. You would be talked about. You would be on national news. CNN would come down there with a camera. They'd be like, did you see the father run? Do you understand what I'm saying? But this father, he gives us an image. He sees a son who's been lost. And there's a father who wants that son to be found. He sees the son lost. He pulls up the robe. He says, I don't care what you think. I don't care what you say. I don't care anything you are about. I'm on my way to find this person. I want the son. These people, religious people are like, there's someone to clear, they're having a meltdown because religion hates it when God loves someone. Because it's not about love to a religious person. It's not about love. It's about what you've done. Listen, whether you're doing your own thing by wanting to shake off all the morality or you're trying to live a moral life, you're both trying to control God. Because this one says, if I do right, God, you have to love me. This one says, God, you're too out of touch. You don't understand the modern era. You don't understand how life isn't like that. God, you don't understand. Both of them end up going, God, you don't understand. And it's a dumb thing to tell God. You don't understand the all-knowing, all-powerful, all-loving, all-wonderful God. You don't know what you're talking about. Because the truth is, who doesn't know what they're talking about? See, what's Jesus trying to do in this story? He's trying to reinvent some names and some figures and some thoughts. And he's trying to help us understand who God really is. Here's the first thing that he's trying to do. He's trying to tell you who God really is. Now, he says, number one, he's the first person in the Bible that begins to call God as a father. Before that, he wasn't a father. He wasn't known as a father. He was known as a redeemer. He was known as the judge. He was known as the king. He was known as everything else, but he was not known as a father. He was a shepherd. He was not known as a father who loves his people. Jesus gets the fact that you don't understand, that maybe you've had a bad father, but he wants to show you what a good father is all about. Why? Because if you don't have that revelation, you'll never know how to father. You'll never know and understand who God really is. He says, can you just put aside your experience? Can you put aside what you think? And can you just see this is what a father's really all about? A father who's wild about his son. A father who'll do anything to be in relationship with that son. A father who'll put up with a son even when the son rejects him. That's the type of father that he's trying to say. See, what's your view of God? How do you see him? Well, he loves me when I'm doing the right thing. He loves you whether you're doing the right thing or not. Oh, he'll only accept me when I get my act together. What a dumb thought this picture shows us. Here, these people, they know they've done the wrong thing and they know they're outside where God wants them to be. And they recognize that their life is in a mess because everything they thought should have happened didn't happen. These people here, they think they're in the right place. They think they've got God cornered, but they're miserable. Ever learn anything about religious people? They're angry all the time. Do you know why they're angry? Because God won't be contained to do what they want him to do. They're like, God, you're not doing it right. I prayed for 4 hours and you didn't answer me. God, I did right and yet this stuff happened to me. That's religion. That's what religious are all about. God, you should have done something, but you didn't. I'm really angry with you. Well, it's okay to be angry, but it's not okay to stay there. You've got to first of all recognize, God, you are a father that loves me. And even when the world turns against me, even when my life falls apart, you are there. And you're loving on me. And you're whispering in my ear saying, there's a way. We can do this together. We can make a life. We can rise up. This is not the end. It's just the beginning. But you've got to solve the problem here. The first thing he does is redefine the nature of who God is. The second thing he does, he redefines what sin is. We think sin is about moral choices. Be good, do good, makes you good. Jesus says, doesn't work. These people here, they're like, man, we just need to have this. We just need to be free to be all we want to be. I just need to let loose the constraints. I just need to do my thing and find my way. And it ends in misery. These people here say, well, I've done the right thing. I've been the right person. I've smiled the right time. I've shunned it. I've runned it. I've done. I've turned up to church. And it still doesn't work. See, sin isn't that issue. Sin is about being humble. Sin is saying, you know what, God, there's nothing real good in me the way I am. You know what, God, whether I'm good or whether I'm bad, I'm still bad. Because both times, all I really want to do is control you and be my own savior. Both times, I just want to say, I've done good, God, therefore you should accept me. Here, well, all those old things, they're so old and ancient. How could I be constrained by that? You're ruining my life. I want to live my life. Hear the difference, hear the same. It's the same voice. See, these people were angry at these people, but they should have been angry at one another because they're both lost. And one of the tragedies of Christian life is that there's a lot of people in church life that are doing good, looking good, feeling good, but just as lost as these people here. Because they haven't realized it's not about what you do, it's about what he's done. And it's because of what he's done, I actually can do something good. I can actually do life with him. And so it's not about a transaction. Well, if I pray 4 hours a week, if I get up in the morning and if I beat my chest, if I do this stuff, we look at all those people that take it to the extreme and say, you people, you're all crazy. But you know what? There's a part of you and I that does the same thing. Every time we haven't prayed enough and we get in a situation, we go, oh, I should have prayed more. That's religion, isn't it? Oh, you know, if only I'd read the Bible more. That's religion. That's religion. Why? Because the Father pulls up his skirt and he runs towards us and he embraces us and he doesn't say, did you read the Bible an hour today? You didn't do your quiet time. We'll do this again tomorrow. So first of all, Jesus is redefining who the Father is. Second, he's redefining what sin is. Sin is whether you're prepared to recognize that whether you're good or whether you're bad, it doesn't matter. It's whether you're prepared to go, God, I need you. I just humble myself. Whether I've been good, whether I've been bad, whether I've lived the best life, whether I've lived the worst life, both of us need to go, you know what, God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for trying to be good to make you do what you... I'm sorry for being bad to try and get your stuff. I'm just sorry. Because God, you're already on my way. Third thing he does, he's redefines salvation and the process of salvation. First thing he does, he redefines who the Father is. Second thing he does, he redefines what sin is. Third thing he does, he redefines salvation. Here's what you got to understand if you want to get into salvation. Number one, the Father's after you. He's never not. The psalmist said, if I make my bed in hell, you're there. We understand that. But we don't believe it. We say, oh, when will we embrace a God that has embraced us? Do you know the moment, I think, in that story that the son truly found salvation was when the father grabbed him and kissed him. It was in that kiss where he realized, he just loves me. It's not what I've done. It's not where I've been. He just loves me. He just loves me. When are we going to get a revelation? He just loves us. He just loves us. He just loves us. He just loves us. Doesn't matter what I've done. Doesn't matter what I don't do. Now, don't get me wrong. You know, when I pray, when I do good, I do position myself for better stuff. But it It doesn't make God and me any different. It doesn't make me any better person. It just makes me have a little better outcome. Does that make sense? So you're better off doing good, but it's not going to save you. It's not going to heal you. It's not going to deliver you. It's not going to get you to rise up in the bad times. What will do that is when you go, oh God, you love me anyway. And I'm just going to embrace you in the middle of that. Second thing you need to do is, after being recognizing when it comes to salvation, recognizing that God is after us, second thing we've got to do is just say, God, I'm sorry for trying to do good to impress you. I'm sorry for trying to manipulate you, God. I thought that if I did good, you'd just do good for me. I thought if I did the right thing, I'd force your hand to do the right thing for me. God just wants to bless you. Goodness and mercy are following you all the days of your life. Why? Because he loves you. You got to get where goodness and mercy is, but just doing good doesn't mean that God is going to do something in that. Because if that's true, these people are miserable because they do good, but bad stuff still happens. And when bad stuff happens, Christians go, why, God? Why is this stuff? I've prayed. I've interceded. What are you really saying? You're saying, God, I thought we had a deal on my terms. And God said, you never had that deal. That's religion. He said, in the bad times, I'll be with you. When chaos comes in, I'll cause you to rise up and have order. When you've got trouble coming against you, I'll stand with you. He didn't say nothing's ever going to go wrong. I think the final part of salvation comes down to, once you recognize that God is after you. Once you recognize that you need to repent from the good and the bad, I think the third thing you've got to do is get melted by the love that's in his heart for you. If we could just see, if we could just sense all the struggle, all the striving, all the shuffling and the pushing and the pointing of the finger, and we just melt. We get so worried about, just rest and melt in his arms and say, God, I'm sorry. In Jewish culture, the older brother always got 2/3 of the inheritance. And I often wondered why. But this story actually tells us. See, in the story of the prodigal son, the father sits at the gate waiting for the prodigal son to come home. But the older brother has 2/3 of the inheritance. And why does he have that? Because he's a good boy? Why does he have that? He's got that because he's meant to go and find the ones that are lost. In fact, under Jewish culture, the older brother was meant to be at the point of bankruptcy to redeem and to solve the problem of his younger brother. Because he understood how much the father loved. He understood how much the father wanted in relationship and the family to stay together. He understood the power of this thing that God had created. That was what it was meant to be all about. And Jesus is telling the story as the older brother of humanity, saying, okay, I understand. I get this thing. There's a father that's after you. There's a father that loves you. Now, as an older brother, I'm prepared to go into bankruptcy so that you can know him, so that you can be in relationship with him, so that you can discover the love that will redeem you, that will change you, that will turn your life around. So he came from heaven and came to earth and died on a cross. We just celebrated Easter. And that's the moral of the story that Jesus is trying to get across. The religious people are sitting there with the Son of God, God's own Son, telling them the story. As an older brother, I am here to bring you two back into relationship with the Father. And I'm prepared to go bankrupt. I'm prepared to give it all so that you can get to know him. Can you see the power of the story that Jesus was trying to get across. Can you see the depth of the story as Jesus began to weigh it out, as these people suddenly discovered there truly is hope, there truly is life, that even if I've done wrong and I've done bad and I've done the wrong thing, there's a way back into the arms of a Father that's absolutely wild about me. It's my prayer when you read the prodigal son, you'll recognize that there's a God that's just extravagantly wasteful to get your attention. That when you're thinking about how you failed God, that you'll stop going in that circle of self-pity and that self of just pulling yourself down and start saying, you know what, God thought me enough that I'm worth it. I'm gonna fall into your arms. You could be the vilest person in the room, you could be the nicest person in the room, but God still loves you just as much. And the question, this story finishes, and it finishes without an ending, because Jesus is saying to both these groups of people, the religious, the other people, he's saying, well, what are you gonna do? How are you gonna live now? You gonna stop your moralizing? Stop your religious life? You gonna stop your, I wanna be free, I wanna be me, you wanna be whatever? And fall into an arms of a God and do life with him that will show you how to really live and how to really make life choices that matter, to how to do life with someone at your side, how to be filled with a spirit, the Holy Spirit that says, come on, we can do this. We can make this together. We can make a life and change the world. That's what Christianity is. It's not a religion. It's not a set of rules. It's not a set of whatever. It's a life of freedom and hope and promise. Can we close our eyes and bow our heads? The time's almost gone, but I know God wants to do a miracle in this last few minutes together. If you've got the wrong image of God as a father, I want to break it off your life. Maybe your father was a total idiot. Maybe the image you had was just terrible. I want to pray that the real image of what God is really like will break into your reality right here, right now. While our heads are bowed and eyes closed, if that's you and you know you need a revelation of a God that as a father that truly loves you, because it'll change the way you do life, it'll change the way you do family, it'll change the way you become a father, or you as a wife will, a mother will deal with your husband, it'll change the way you work with your children. If you need a revelation of who God is in your life as a father, I wonder whether you just raise your hand and just let me know. And I'm going to pray with you that God will just meet with you right here, right now. Just give me a wave in Jesus' name. Yeah, people all over this room, all over this amazing auditorium, God's going to meet with you. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that this word would renew their thinking, would become life within them, like a two-edged sword would cut out the wrong thinking and the world and the mess that just humanity has made within their understanding of who a father really is, and that like a light you would flood into their very reality about who you are and how much you're for them. And Lord, that no matter what has happened by an earthly father, I pray that, Lord, there'd be healing, freedom, and deliverance from that, so that life and light would shine in Jesus' name.